Good morning. Today, the 5th of January, we are basically discussing quickly some MCQ question with a little interactive way. So try with it. Okay. Let's. This is the first question, is very easy. Macro is an assembly language program. What is the answer? So answer should be subprogram. But you always remember that macro processing is done at the beginning of the compiling. It is done by the preprocessor, like all like header file definition or macro definition. This is the macro, so this is a subprogram. The answer is the subprogram. It is done before precompiler, or the compiler before acting on it. Okay. Next slide. Yeah, difference between macro and function is that macro, there is no type checking. Type checking is done. Macro is pre-processed, so it is, it adds to the code space, but it is faster, because if for a function you have to use stack, you have to push all the things, and function is slower, but macro is faster, but it takes up space. Code length increases, that I have told. Use of macro can lead to side effect. Yes, speed of execution is definitely faster. Really, macro is useful for small code. Okay, fine. So, next slide. The lexical analyzer takes as input and produces a stream of, this is very easy. Lexical analyzer forces a source program and produce stream as tokens. Sometimes it is the lexeme, but tokens is the best answer. So, this is easy. So, this is the compiler. The lexical analysis is the first stage, pass one. So, yeah, any question you can raise right now. Yeah, any question. This is easy questions. Yeah, lexical analysis of a modern computer language such as Java needs power of which one of the following machine language? Yes, the lexical analysis, you can say that PDA is more powerful machine, Turing machine is more powerful. Why not use it? But not, but it is unnecessary wastage of, in fact, that is a wastage. So, it can be done by finite state machine, by regular expression. What is regular expression? Regular expression about the variables. The variables start with a, like any A, B, C, D, and it can be any numeral. It cannot start with number. So, it can be detected by regular expressions, and that is fine by any regular expression. Can be catched by non-deterministic finite state machine and deterministic finite state machine. So, it is the answer. Okay, but others can do it, but this is a wastage. Okay, this is the compiler analysis stage. This is the synthesis stage. You can ask any question. Let's go to the next slide. In a compiler, keywords of a language, a token, yeah, in a compiler, keywords of a language are recognized during, it is always a lexical analysis of the program. But in the lexical analysis, these are the things will be taken out, like comment, like I am saying, this is a preprocessor directive, this is a preprocessor, this is taken away. So it will be taken away by the lexical analysis, only the and also tokens are identified. But if you say any integer variable I is initialized, whether I is initial with floating point number, that will not be the part of the lexical analysis, that is not the part of the syntax analysis also, that will be done by the semantic analysis. Whether integer is fed with integer or floating point done, that will be done after syntax analysis. Okay. The lexical analysis identify the tokens. Next slide. Yeah. So, this is the, it is lexer, and this is the, after syntax analysis parser, it will tokens after lexical analysis. Okay. Okay, this is a question. This is already giving you a lot of time. This is a very favorite question. Here, the catch is that the number of tokens will be 10. This whole string is a one token. This is one token. This is one token. This is one token. This is one token. If you count it, it will be number of token will be 10. If you please check it. Yeah. This is a token. The whole catch is the whole string is a token, not individual. This is string. Okay. So, total number of token is 10. Great. Yes. Compiler can diagnose grammatical errors and the logical errors. Logical errors cannot be, because logical errors, if you program and make some fundamental logical errors, it cannot be done. So, logical, grammatical as a no, it is cannot be done, only grammatical error. Grammatical error, mainly the syntax errors, okay. So, compiler can detect only that. Any question, please, anybody can please raise a question, I will be It will be live class. So it will be nice to hear. Any question, any doubt, any difference of opinion, or if you agree with some of you, say yes, sir, that will be great, nice, great sound. Yeah. Yeah. So, which of the data structures is used in managing information of the variables and the symbol table? And the symbol table is, it can be in array, it can be in a tree, but 99% it is a hash table, because you know the array, the complexity is O(n), tree is also complexity is there. So, hash table can give you the complexity near to O(1). So, it has to be very fast, because the whole symbol table has to be stored in computer primary memory, and when the compiler is running a program, say 100 line programs can have a symbol table, maybe 1000 entries, and the 1000 and more than 1000 entries. So, it should, and every stage from lexical analysis, syntax, semantic, code generation, code optimization, every stage the symbol table is consulted, rather looked up to. So, symbol table has to be done in a, not only in primary memory, it has to be, data structure should be pretty fast, like a dictionary kind of thing in a Python, same as a hash table. Hash table can be done by a dictionary, more both are synonymous almost. Yes. In the compiler language, I recognize, yeah, this is lexical analysis of the program. I think this is the, I repeat question. Lexical analysis is the token language keywords is the lexical analysis of the program, always. A system program that set up an executable program in main memory ready for execution is loaded. Please, these are all system programs. The main system program is operating system, then is the assembler, assembly language to machine language, then is the compiler, any source code to the assembly language level, assembler level. But finally, the linker, different modules are there, linker will link this, and finally, loader loads a module in the computer memory. So, this is a loader, this is a loader's role, loader is the final loads the process. So, this is the CP processor, say it takes care of the macros, compiler, after compiler, this assembler, then linker, then the loader. So, the answer is the system program that set up an executable program in memory is a loader. So, it cannot be linker. Linker links many object files, then a final file will be loaded and it can be, should be relocatable. So, in memory address space where is the vacancies available there, it will put it. So, it is loader. Okay. Any question, you please raise the question. This kind of question, yes, this is grammar of the problem. Grammar of the program is checked that, yeah, syntax analysis. Not lexical analysis, the syntax. This is the main vital thing. You know, the syntax analysis is basically from arrays of tokens, it will try to get out the parse tree or abstract syntax tree. The parse tree should be unique. If it is a definitely programming language, an unambiguous language, so it should generate the parse tree or abstract syntax tree, that is the role of syntax analysis. So, this is the output of the syntax analysis. Yeah. A symbol table implemented based on the property of locality of reference. I have told this has to be hash table. Linear list it can be done, but it will be pretty slow. Search tree is also slow. This is also slow. Hash table is actually the answer. Why do you care if a grammar is ambiguous? A different semantic meaning is associated with different parse tree. So, grammar has not to be ambiguous. So, grammar has to be unambiguous. And there is great point in it, like all LL1 grammar we know or LR1 grammar is basically unambiguous. So, first of all, for all practical purpose, programming language for context-free grammar, you know. But deterministic context free grammar, non-deterministic context free grammar, we need non-deterministic PDA, which is very difficult to build. So, it should be non-deterministic context free grammar. Even non-deterministic context free grammar, not all grammar, not all language has a grammar, first of all. So, if you can find grammar, it has to be unambiguous. In unambiguous, if it is a, that grammar, unambiguous grammar is suitable for programming, but then you have to see whether the language is suitable for parsing, like LL1, grammar is very easy for parsing. LR1 is a better powerful grammar for bottom up parsing. Not all deterministic context free language can have a grammar, that you must remember. But generally, all unambiguous grammar in the deterministic context free grammar. Okay. So, grammar has to be unambiguous in a programming language, otherwise, two different meaning of this. Yeah. This is easy. This is easy match. So, lexical analysis match with what? Lexical analysis match with left-post derivation, type checking, irregular expression. So, basic foundation of lexical analysis is regular expression. Top-down parsing. Top-down parsing, you know, it is always a left-post derivation. This is semantic analysis. Semantic analysis and the runtime environments. Runtime environments, you feel it, runtime environments is always is a activation records is more is S. This is the answer S4. Semantic analysis, here is the point, the whether they will check type checking, whether the you are putting integer into integer, floating point, all this type checking and this thing will be done by a semantic analysis. Okay. So, B is the answer. Yeah. Compiler should report the presence of errors in source programming. The compiler can detect classes, objects, but main purpose is an error. It is meaningless whether the classes or objects. It is at the after compiler is successful, then you can think of classes, objects, and all. Text is not, it is a text processor. So, final thing is of errors. If there any single error, compiler should not compile. So, and the not only that, it will report errors, and it will report errors in such a way, say the programmer can correct the error. So, not only one error it comes out, it takes a bunch of errors and reports the result, at which line the error is there, what is the suppose, whether the semicolon is missing or bracket is missing, it will try to help. So, here the answer is errors. Given the, this is very good question, this given the following expression, the grammar, which has the following true. So, here you see catch is there, the f is associated with f minus f. So, you are not finding with f star f. So, it is a give a more higher precedence, remember. So, if it is a, if there is another rule f to f star f, then both have the same precedence, because this particular rule minus has a higher precedence, but which is not to be in our programming language, but here it is. As per this question, the B is the answer because of this is rule. Yeah. Any question you can always ask. Intermediate code generation phase gets input for, it is always the semantic analyzer, because after this, semantic is after syntax analysis, from there the intermediate code generation. A simple two-pass assembler does which of the following in the first pass? It allocates space for the literals, calculates the total length, it done all these things. So, D is the answer. This grammar, this is interesting course. This is the interesting question. This grammar is this. So, it is, you think that all the rules starts from a different symbol A, B. So, it is a fit case for LL1. So, if it is a, if grammar is LL1, then it should be LR1 also. So, you know LR1 is a superset of LL1. So, LR1 contains LL1. So, the reason is this, the A is the answer, both LL1 and LR1. Because you see the, if you see the first of this, if the first of this is A, first of B S is also B, first of C. So, these first are all mutually exclusive. This is not the definite answer that it should be LL1, because all the options are there. So, for finding LL1, you have to go one more step, like all are mutually exclusive, then any variable is epsilon or not, no variable is go to epsilon. So, you do not have to check first and follow of this, then you have to, then you can declare this, this is a LL1. This is one operator, bottom-up parsing. Bottom-up parsing is a two type of parsing. One is operator grammar, which is easier, like very easy, and another is LR1 parsing. So this is bottom up parsing. The rule is that between two variables, the operator should be there. No epsilon transition, no variable can note epsilon, no two adjacent down terminals. So it should be like this, like this. So which of the following grammar rules are the question is, which of the following grammar rules violate the requirements of operator grammar? Operator grammar, if you see our all arithmetic expression, mainly infix type of arithmetic expression is can be well represented by operator grammar, and it is very easy for parser table design and all these things are easy for operator grammar. Only things the operator should be in between, and it is a bottom up parsing. It can be handled by bottom up parsing. Yes. So here it is not typically not. Not operator grammar, this is also not. So, answer is 1 and 3 only. Okay. So, that is it. Yeah, the same, it give another example of operator grammar. This is example of operator grammar. Say this is example. Okay. The answer is this. Okay, first and follow how to calculate this thing, very easy. See, this is a particular thing. What is the first of S? First of S, it can be A, okay. It can be B, okay. So, this is the first of A and B, and others is first of A, and first of B, you say A, B, and epsilon, okay. And what is the follow of S? See, follow of S always be dollar, always, because S is the starting symbol. So, always you should put dollar in the first place, because after this end, and then it is a follow, who can follow S? See, definitely here, because A is there and here the B is there, okay. So, this way you calculate first and follow. It's very easy because very essential for top down parsing also and also bottom up parsing, because first and follow, because in bottom up parsing also, whenever the panic error, the compiler stops at the follow signals of the any variable, and the follow signal should contain semicolon and bracket. So, that is the generally the whenever the computer comes out, the compiler program comes out of the pandemic. So, it will take, that is the marker, the follow signals between this. Okay, the first and follow is very, very vital for non recursive parsing. To top down and bottom up parsing with a no backtracking. So, this is very important. Definition of fast, I think I have covered it. So, let us have the question first. Yeah. What is the grammar of the below question? See here, what are the other questions? See here, initially there is no conflict. It will be LL1. Okay. Here SLR1, but this cannot be, because SLR1 is always a superset of LL1. By logic, without taking out this question, you can cut out this. SLR1 basically superset of LR0. LR0 is superset of LL1, LL0, and LL1, SLR1, it is a wrong answer. If it is the grammar is, it is a wrong answer. LL1, LL1, this is also wrong, this is also wrong. So, this is the correct answer. So, there is no conflict. So, this is it. Any question you please raise. Yeah. Which of the following suffices to convert the arbitrary context free grammar to LL1 grammar? I have covered it. So, this definitely removing left recursion is one step. Then factoring grammar alone, factoring grammar is also one step. Removing left recursion and factoring, this is also very vital step, but that does not guarantee you that is LL1 grammar. That is the answer is none of this. It does not guarantee you, because ultimately you have to create a parsing table and you have to see that for every variable and every left hand side any variable and on the top hand side the terminal, there should be one and one entry. Before that also you can check that no left recursion, no and whether any variable is nullable or not. If it is nullable, the first of that variable and follow up that variable intersection should be shy, and all the left, that is it. Then you can say the grammar is LL1. So, that does not guarantee you that removing left recursion and factoring doesn't guarantee you deliver. Chances is there, high chances is there, but that's it. Yeah. And remember this LL1, one is enough, one, two, some people say, particularly for LR1, LR1 is very powerful grammar. You did not to be LR2 because for maintaining a LR1 table is a huge one because, but LL1 and LL2 is enough for LL1. Which of the following is a top down parser? Yes, top down parser, you know, LR cannot be top down, LLR not. These are all bottom up parser. These are all bottom up parser, and recursive descent parser is a top down parser. And whenever recursive descent without backtracking, then we call LL1 parsing. Okay, but LL1, for LL1 parsing, you need to be grammar to be LL1. But for any recursive descent parser, if it is ambiguous, it can be in recursive descent parser can do this, but there might be some backtracking. But this is essentially is a top down. So we are getting from S and we are taking the depth first tree and we are going for the, and sometimes the, it does not match, so then you can go back. That is called backtracking. So recursive descent parser, some backtracking might be there. But if we take the LL1 grammar, no backtracking guaranteed. Okay. Which of the following statement is false? Left as well as rightmost derivation can be unambiguous. So that is, I have probably explained in earlier, it is a false. So, yeah. Which of the following suffices to convert an arbitrary CFG to LLR grammar? That I have told, I probably have done it earlier. Removing left recursion and four factors do not suffice. So, repeat question, sorry. This is important question. Here we say a grammar is there. A grammar is there. You can calculate follow of B. So, what is follow of B? Say S follow definitely dollar and follow of B, follow of B must be first of D. So, is the follow of B here, first of D, and D can go to epsilon because D can give epsilon. So, it can be follow of F. So, follow of B is equal to first of D union follow of A. So, that way D is calculated. This kind of one question, and you have to say it will be indexed like this. You have to in your MCQ question, you have to answer like this way. Okay. The bottom up parsing is called, yes, it's shift reduced parsing. So, predictive parsing, it is not, it is a top down parsing. Recursive descent parsing is a top down parsing. So, bottom up parsing is a basically, we are shift reduced parsing, either shift reduced, so it is a shift reduced parsing. One great thing is, have you heard of Donald Knuth? He has developed the LR parsing. He has a 7 book on computer science. Art of Programming volume 1 to 7 that is readable for every computer scientist if you can find time. So, Donald Knuth who developed the text LaTeX, which is the text programming language for typesetting. He has lots of contribution in data structure, lots of algorithms like Dijkstra. The Dijkstra algorithm, I think you have heard this, and this Donald Knuth is also very famous. So, he developed this bottom up parser. So, which are the following LR parser? Rightmost is different, that is the bottom up parsing main thing. He developed it in, I think, maybe 60s. Yeah, that is another, because the bottom up parsing, the parsing table is huge. See, if it is a LR1 table, if it is a 100 line program, it may be, parse table may be 1 million entries. So, it is a huge, so that is the reason we may not go for the LR1, we go for LALR1, that is a table is much sizable, is comparably smaller, maybe comparable smaller by 10, by 100 or 1000. So, for creating table like you have developed, we can develop the top down passing table, but here it is very difficult. You need a program, yet another compiler, that is the program name, that automatically creates this LALR parsing table. So, this LALR, you have a one programming that is called YACC, yet another compiler. Okay. So, if a state does not know whether it will make a shift operation or reduction in a terminal call, that is very obvious from its answer, shift reduce, because when the bottom up parsing, the parsing is they try to get it from the right hand side and try to match something which the we can replace the rule. That is, whenever we replace the rule, that means we are reducing it, and until and we are reducing it, we are making a shift. So, there is always a decision between shift and reduce. So, whenever you get a reducible form, then we reduce it by the law, okay. Then we try to further reduce it or shift it. So, ultimately S should come, the final thing after reduction, after this thing traverses, the S should come. But here also we must think there should be no backtracking in input. The input cannot, each input go to only one direction, okay. And there is a stack is there, here also stack is there. So, you can anything is unmatched, you put it onto the stack. You try to meet the top end of the stack whether it matches any variable or not. So, we read it and put it into the stack and we try to see whether we can match it with a variable. This is it. We put it into the stack, then if we find it something is available, so we push it and also the stack. And the state of the system, the major thing is difference between top down and bottom up. Here you also have a every stack as a state. So, with the variables and terminals, we put the state into it. And this is the this table is generated by a YACC for LALR parser. So, yeah. What is the similarity between LR, LALR and SLR? See here it is LL0. See, LL0 is no use, effective is LL1, at least one symbol you should look at. So, you see the lots of power, it is not proportional, but LL1 is very powerful. A modern Python language can be designed on this. LL1 and LL2, these are very Python 3.9 have a LL1 compiler into it. And always LR, LL0 is no relevant, LR0 same. So, we will consider LL1, and you see the LR1 is also must be superset. LR1, most of the programming languages construct, 99% of the programming constructs can be done by LR1, okay. And this is it, the advantages and disadvantages. Using same algorithm, the parsing table is different. The parsing different table is huge for LR and simplest in SLR, and LLR is medium. So, generally it is done LLR. Yeah. The most powerful parser is this is a canonical, there is LR1 basically, is it? And there is a always entries should be either reduce, shift, go to particular state. We reserve the state and accept the state. So, these are the entries. So, the most powerful parser is LLR is also very sufficiently closer, SLR is less powerful. Operator precision is a bottom up parser, but it is no way, there are lot of restriction in the grammar. So, operator must be between two variables. So, this is a quite a restriction for operator precision grammar. Bottom up parsing. Yeah, this is an interesting question. What is the maximum number of reduced move that can be taken for a by bottom up parser for a grammar with no epsilon and a unit production like this to parse it? So, if the n number of tokens, it cannot be 2n-1, because why? Then definitely if n tokens and if have need 2n, then definitely backtracking is there. So, you can obviously take out these, it is also n/2, it is not possible, it is not a tree. So, and n/2 may be fraction, so it is not. So, obvious answer should be n or n-1, but more of n is option is not there, so n-1 is the answer. Yeah, this is the LRK parsing, left to right, rightmost derivation and k Lucas. Generally, one is sufficient. And LR1 is the superset of LL1. LR process is attractive because it does not backtrack, this is very vital. LL1 also does not backtrack, but LL1 has a restriction that you do not have all the no left recursive allowed, but LR1 left recursion is allowed, right recursion is also allowed, left recursion, right recursion is a more general. Yeah. SLR is a canonical and SLR is a simple, CLR is more powerful, is a bottom up parsing technique, more powerful. I will go into bit details into CLR and SLR in the next Saturday class, or I am making another entry. So, that is it. Here, this is very important. Assume SLR parser for grammar is N1 states and LLR grammar is N2 states, the relationship N1 and N2, N1 is necessarily equal to N2. Yeah. This is, I will go into detail, but you try to first try to make it a little bit of understanding, so I will go into detail. Which of the following is true for the left recursive grammar? It causes a recursive grammar process to loop forever, that is the problem, left recursion is not allowed. Okay. So, left recursion in general ambiguous grammar, no, bottom parser it is no, so left recursion probably gives the loop, looping is there. Consider the following grammar, this is interesting, say this is a grammar, this is a variable and it can sometimes give to P terminal, sometimes to C terminal, H, D and C, which are the two, all strings generated by S can be LL1, it is cannot be true because you are not sure whether if it is a C, whether it is come from H or F, so it cannot be LL1. See, F can produce C, H can produce C. So, whenever you see a terminal, the C is there, whether you make it with F or H, both cases in LL1 and LL2, both cannot be done. So, S1 and S2 both is not possible. So, none of the mention. Please try to understand this grammar, whenever for P and D is okay, but for C, for LL1 and LR1 also, whether C comes from F, whether C comes from H, you cannot show. So, the answer is none of the mentioned. Thank you.